Testing, testing, 1, 2, am I live? Okay. Welcome. Welcome in the name of Jesus, the Savior of the world. Welcome to all of you, all of those who are gathered here and back in the Soldier Hall, and to all of you, and those of you who are watching at home through this live stream. Thank you for being here with the family. We are gathered to worship, to proclaim Christ crucified and risen, to remember before God our brother Rich, to give thanks for his life, to commend his life to our merciful Redeemer, and to comfort one another in our grief. Please stand as you are able in respect for the family as they enter, and we will hear the words of Amazing Grace.
I wanted you for life, you and me. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found, was blind, but now I see. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've no less days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. We've no less days to sing God's praise than when we
with the placing of the pall. The pall is a symbolic garment that we place on the casket as a remembrance of the baptismal garments we wear and the gowns of white that we wear before God's throne. It's also symbolic of our equality before God. Please join me in the dialogue as it's placed. When we were baptized in Christ Jesus, we were baptized into his death. We were buried, therefore, with him by baptism into death, so that as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, we too might live a new life. For if we have been united with him in a death like his, we shall certainly be united with him in a resurrection like his. All who were baptized in Christ have put on Christ. In his baptism, Rich was clothed with Christ. In the day of Christ's coming, he shall be clothed with glory. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. O God of grace and glory, we remember before you today our brother Richard Liljenquist. We thank you for giving him to us, to know and to love as a companion in our pilgrimage on earth. In your boundless compassion, console us who mourn. Give us faith to see that death has been swallowed up in the victory of our Lord Jesus Christ, so that we may live in confidence and hope until by your call we are reunited with those who have gone before us. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated. And now we have a remembrance from her family.
It's Kay, and I'm Rich and Lorraine's youngest daughter. On behalf of my mom, my sister Valerie, my brother Rick, and our families, we want to thank you all for being here as we celebrate the life of my dad. Dad had humble beginnings, and his youth was not easy. He and mom were married, or were high school sweethearts, and were married in 1956, the same year they graduated from high school. They raised us three kids here in Aiken, and we too all graduated from Aiken High School. Now, I won't stand here and tell you Dad was always the best father and husband, because at times he was neither. He was an alcoholic and struggled with some relationships, even with those closest to him. At different times in our lives, our relationships were strained. We disappointed him, and he disappointed us. But as a family, we rebuilt those relationships. We chose love and forgiveness over bitterness and hatred. Our mom taught us how to love and forgive, and I can proudly say we all enjoyed many years with strong relationships with Dad. When I was 10 years old, Dad finally became sober. As he worked his program, he was instrumental in helping others find their sobriety. Back in the mid-70s, he worked with others in the AA program to get the Alano Club built. The phone would ring in the middle of the night when he began to drive intoxicated people to detox either in Grand Rapids or Brainerd. The sheriff's department depended on him to assist them in dealing with those under the influence. Sometimes situations could have been dangerous, but he always was willing to go into a home or a jail cell to talk to someone, and he had a way of calming them down. He had been where they were, and somehow he was able to de-escalate the situations so law enforcement or families were able to take the next steps. Mom would ride along if Dad was transporting a female, or just to ride along. One night, they took three trips to detox, and both had to work the next day. I rode along one night to transport a very intoxicated woman who was from Duluth. Her name was Sally, and a truck driver she was riding with must have gotten tired of her because he dropped her off on the side of the road just east of town. She had a laundry basket full of stuff, including a very small kitten, and of course, her bottle of booze and 2-liter bottle of Coke. That experience stuck with me, and I saw firsthand the compassion and respect he showed to an obviously troubled person. Dad and his brother Eddie started Liljenquist Sewer and Excavating back in the late 1960s. They installed sewers, dug basements, and did dirt work. My cousin Larry now has the business. Dad also had a sewer truck and pumped sewers around the area, often 7 days a week. Back then, he wasn't sober yet, and he would share stories with us about the pranks he and Eddie and others would do to each other as they worked alongside each other on jobs. I won't say too much about these shenanigans, but one or two stories included a grease gun and dog poop. If you see Doug Bear, you can ask him about it. After that, he worked for McDonald Wold, and he probably sold a vehicle or two to some of you during those years. In the mid-1980s, Dad wanted to work in the chemical dependency field. In 1987, he received a medal for being the first man to receive a diploma from St. Catherine's College. It was originally a woman's college, but joined St. Mary's, where he completed his chemical dependency course. I think the job he was most proud of was becoming the first coordinator and crew leader for the Sentence to Serve program. Many of the men and women he worked with had drug or alcohol offenses. His life experience and his CD counselor training was put to good use. And when I say worked with, he really did. He worked right alongside the offenders as they worked off their jail time or fines. They did what was needed around the county, like cleaning the fairgrounds, ditches, preparing for parades or festivals, and also working the day of the events. Dad also encouraged them to use their talents building birdhouses, which were often donated for fundraisers, and many a picnic table in the county were built in his program. He was respected by everyone and rarely had any problems with his crew because he respected them despite the reason they were in trouble. He retired in 2003, and his retirement party brought many to honor him for all he did for his community. I remember being told a lady from Duluth came to his retirement party. I don't remember all the details, but it was something about Dad fighting for her to be allowed to work off her jail time in his SDS program so she could reduce her jail time and get back to her family. I also remember him being invited to a young man's baptism. That's the effect Dad had on people's lives. Many times over the years, I would meet people and tell them who my dad was, and I would see a sheepish grin, and they would say, "Oh, I know your dad." So I knew they'd either been in the back of his detox squad car or they had worked for him in the STS program. The things Dad got paid to do while working for STS, he started to do as a volunteer. He was on the Aiken County Fair Board for many years, and he especially loved the Aiken County Fair. He spent countless hours preparing the grounds for the fair. He was there every day of the fair, from early in the morning picking up garbage and emptying garbage cans to late at night after the grandstand events. Triple R Racing, which stands for Rich, Rick, and Roland, was formed, and stock car racing was brought back to Aiken. It was a family affair, and Mom, Kim, and I worked the ticket booth alongside Dad, and Rick and Roland ran the show. Because of Dad's endless desire to improve the Aiken County Fair, he brought the ever-popular bus races to town, and in 2019, over 2,000 fans came to the races, which was a record for the fair. Thanks to Vern Waters, Dad's years of dedication to the Aiken County Fair Board, the grandstands were named after him last July 24th on his 82nd birthday. We kept it a surprise from him, and the unveiling was truly memorable with lots of tears. The celebration continued at Rick and Kim's, where Toby and Jen and their food trucks served us all our favorite foods. It's hard to imagine an Aiken event without Dad, but all I can say is I hope they were taking notes. He loved greeting people at the Sports and Commerce Show in the spring and working festivals and parades throughout the year. One year, he made three appearances in the same parade, first as the Grand Marshal, then he and Mom drove their restored 1956 turquoise and white Crown Victoria with the Country Road Classics Car Club, and finally, in a golf cart with a shovel and bucket, following the horses as the Super Duper Pooper Scooper. He also volunteered countless hours preparing for the car show and fly-in breakfast at the airport. On the day of the event, he and Mom would drive the 56 Crown to the car show, and then they would get to work in the kitchen, helping serve breakfast and lunch. And of course, they stayed after helping with cleanup. Because of Dad's extensive contributions to the community, he was honored to be the recipient of one of Aiken's highest honors, the Warren Potter Award. This was also a surprise, and my sister came from Superior and had to hide from him until he was called to the front of the event center to receive the award. In 2019, he and Mom were named Outstanding Senior Citizens for Aiken County. A highlight of that honor was a trip down to the State Fair. Rick and Kim, Roland and I, and our oldest son, Kylan, accompanied Mom and Dad, and we had a blast. We asked him what he wanted to see, and we did it, including the big pig, looking at tractors, and watching a taping of the WCCO News. One of my mom's favorite awards given to my dad was when he was named Woman of the Year by the Aiken Women of Today. As you can see by the photo boards, his family was everything to him. As his children, we each had a different role. When he talked about my sister Val, he beamed with pride and said, "My daughter is an RN. Val, your guidance through the challenges of aging bring us all comfort, and we're so grateful you were close by during the hospital stays in Duluth. Rick, your relationship with Dad was a joy to watch. Even though I vividly remember the not so good years, you bonded over your family, your hobbies, and your sobriety. You and Kim gave Mom and Dad wonderful experiences, and your never-ending talents make us all proud. Now, I'm not sure what I bring to the family. Not only was I born a Liljenquist, but I was also born a redhead. When I was little, I thought my red hair came from my mom's dad, my Grandpa Ernie. But in 1971, Dad grew a beard for the contest during Aiken's centennial celebration, and his beard was red. Being a Liljenquist and a redhead is most likely the reason for my strong personality. One of my mottos is, you want me on your side. We all got our work ethic from our parents. As a local realtor, I know they are both very proud of me, but their involvement is instrumental in my success. They were always eager to assist me when a house needed cleaning out so I could sell it. This meant hours of dirt and dust, but we always did it with a smile on our faces. Dad was always a wonderful grandfather. He and Mom came to sporting events and sat through concerts, dance recitals, musicals, and graduations. He was so proud of all of them and always wanted to know what they were doing in their lives and their work. If you looked at the photo boards, you saw several photos of Mom and Dad dressed in silly costumes for Halloween. They did this for the grandchildren when they came trick-or-treating, and then they'd go to the sheriff's office to help hand out candy. For some reason, Dad often dressed as a woman. One year, I was told he went into the local thrift store to buy a bra. The bigger, the better. And it was big, if you saw those pictures. His grandchildren were the light of his life, but the great-grandsons stole his heart. My first grandson, Simon, finally got to meet his great-grandparents only days before Dad passed. I am sad Simon won't know either of his great-grandfathers, but he will know them through the stories we will tell him. Our spouses, Bruce, Kim, and Roland, were loved by my dad. Roland jokes that he doesn't think Dad ever got mad at him in his 32 years in the family. I can honestly say I don't think he got mad at Bruce or Kim either. That's probably because he had compassion for them, knowing being part of the Liljenquist family wasn't always going to be easy. Being with family was his favorite place to be, especially if it was sitting around Rick and Kim's campfire, enjoying whatever was being served. The man loved fish, and Roland kept a steady supply of Red Lake walleye for fish fries for family and sometimes friends. I would often sit next to Dad as he enjoyed his meal and watching the great-grandchildren run and play. I would say, "Aren't we lucky, Dad?" And he would say, "Yes, we are." The last year of Dad's life was rough. A little over a year ago, he got sick and had two major surgeries. We were pretty sure we were going to lose him last year and actually said goodbye to him a few times. But God knew our family needed more time with him. Dad had extended stays in hospitals and a coda, but he rallied and was able to come home a few more times. COVID did rob us of in-person visits, but we were the lucky ones. So many were not able to hold their loved ones' hands and say goodbye in person. With Mom's loving care, he was able to be home, and they learned to live with his limitations. There were more Jeep rides to take, more fish dinners to eat, more visits with family and friends, another great-grandson to meet, more conversations to have, and many more I love yous to be said and heard. To top off his health challenges last year, he had another heart attack just before deer hunting season last fall. Before he was released from Abbott, he asked the doctor if he could go deer hunting. The doctor looked at this 82-year-old man and said, "Why not?" So a day or so after getting out of the hospital, Mom got Dad in the gator, drove him a short distance behind the house, helped him up a short flight of stairs into his deluxe deer stand. Rick built it for him a few years ago, and it's heated and insulated, so Mom and Dad could sit together while Mom would read a book and Dad would hunt. I think the deer were pretty safe last year. Roland thinks he hunted every day last season except for a few days. Dad went back to Abbott a few weeks ago for another stent. His heart function decreased, and after he came home, things didn't improve. We knew he would not recover this time, so we started making preparations for what was to come. He wasn't in pain, but he was so very tired. His mind was still sharp, which is yet another gift from God. Last Friday, on Rick's 33rd sobriety anniversary, he presented Dad with his 46th sobriety anniversary medallion, which was the next day and the day Dad passed. How fitting that he died on his sobriety anniversary. Between Dad, Rick, and Roland, they share a combined 110 years of sobriety. Last Saturday started out pretty good. When Roland and I got to the house late morning, he was eating a malt Val brought to him. He and Rick were watching Tractor TV, so we felt we could leave for a while, but planned to come back later in the afternoon, believing we had him for another day. In my heart, I believe Dad, although sleeping, could hear the chatter in the other room while Mom visited with family and felt she was surrounded by love so he could go. And that's what he did. The bonus year with Dad we received from God is a priceless gift and a blessing in the truest form.
Mom, thank you for loving Dad. Because of you, our family stayed intact. Val and Rick, our dad did some things wrong, but he did more things right. His family was his greatest blessing, and through us, his legacy will live on. Thank you.
Thank you, Kay. That was quite awesome and beautiful and an absolute spot-on accurate reflection of my father-in-law. I used to always say, my father-in-law's rich. And he'd always say, oh boy, you're going to be disappointed. But he was rich in many things, and as you hear that, he was rich in life, rich in love, rich in family, and it was the beautiful thing. We'll follow that with some readings. A reading from 1 Timothy, the 6th chapter. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and for which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. In the presence of God, who gives to life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who was the testimony before Pontius Pilate, made the good confession, I charge you to keep the commandment without spot or blame until the manifestation of our Lord Jesus Christ, which we will bring about at the right time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and Lord of lords. It is he alone who has immortality and dwells in inapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him to be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. And for those in the present age, command them not to be haughty or to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but rather on God, who richly provides us with everything for our enjoyment. They are to be good, to be rich in good works, generous and ready to share, thus storing up for themselves the treasure of good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of the life that really is life. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me to lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside the still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in the path of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for you are with me. Your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My cup runs over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. A reading from Hebrews, the 12th chapter. Since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us also lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with the perseverance of the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who for the sake of the joy that was set before him endured the cross, disregarding its shame, and has taken a seat at the right hand of the throne. The word of the Lord.
Please stand as you are able for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 11th chapter. At that time Jesus said, all things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light. This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Please be seated, and we'll now hear One Day at a Time.
I'm only human. I'm just a man. Help me to believe in what I can be and all that I am. Show me the stairway that I have to climb. And Lord, for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you. Give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. So for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. Do you remember when you walked among men? Well, Jesus, you know, if you're looking below, it's worse now than then. Pushing and shoving, crowding my mind. So for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. One day at a time, sweet Jesus, that's all I'm asking of you. Give me the strength to do every day what I have to do. Yesterday's gone, sweet Jesus, and tomorrow may never be mine. So for my sake, teach me to take one day at a time. Yes, for just my sake, teach me to take one day at a time.
Dear grieving family and friends, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Kay did a great job of sharing Rich's life story with you already. And Rich wouldn't want this service to go on too long, so I'll try to keep my message brief today. Coming together like this is never easy. It's difficult because we've all lost a dear family member and friend. But we're together today because we need each other to lean on. That's the way that Rich would want it. Family and friends were extremely important to him. We gather today to comfort one another in our grief and to receive the comfort that only God can give. Jesus said, come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Rest for your soul. That's the comfort that Rich was seeking all his life. He had a difficult childhood, and that was a burden he carried with him. And so he sought comfort, and he found comfort in so many things in life. The first was his beloved Lorraine. They shared nearly 65 years together. Now, you all know those weren't always good years, but Lorraine was the constant in Rich's life. She was the glue that held their family together. She saw them all through the struggles to become the close-knit family they are now. God bless you, Lorraine. Rich found comfort in his family. As you listen to the stories of Rich's life, you hear that as a constant theme, family. Rich always had his family gathered around him, whether it was building something or fixing something or restoring something or having one of their countless family campfires and cookouts or off-roading with jeeps or four-wheelers on their own trails. There are so many other activities. Rich was most at peace with his family. Rich saw a little of himself in his 1956 Crown Vic and his old tractors. He took something that most other people would just toss on the scrap heap, and he rebuilt it and restored it to its full glory. He found comfort in resurrecting things. What was it in Rich that needed to be redeemed? Unfortunately, in his younger days, until, as you heard, 46 years ago, Rich tried to find comfort in ways that he was later ashamed of. He'd be the first to tell you that there's no real comfort in a bottle. If life is, as St. Paul called it, the race set before us, then this is where Rich stumbled. But he recovered. And the way he came back in his race was a sight to see. Rich knew that he had taken so much in his life, and he dedicated the rest of his life to giving back. Rich took comfort in community. He gave so much to this community. He worked with the Chamber of Commerce and in the events like the Commerce and Sports Show and the Festivals of Adventures and at Riverboat Days and the Fish House Parade and the Fly-In Drive-In. He helped with the McGregor Lions Corn Feed. He was on the Fair Board and the Parks Board. He worked with the Women of Today and was the bingo caller for the Alano Building for 13 years. And the list of his contributions and accomplishments goes on and on. Did you see the paper this week? Front page, above the fold, full line headline. Master of the Grandstand, it says. That's a comeback. But for all the accolades, as Kay said, Rich might have found more comfort in the work he did with individuals. He got his degree as a chemical dependency counselor. He was passionate about his work with the Sentence to Serve program because he could see himself and the people he helped. He helped them overcome their addictions and start a new life. He was a mentor and a father figure to many of them. He was a guide. He helped them see that addiction is not the measure of a person. And what made Rich great was that he was so perfectly imperfect. He wasn't the holier-than-thou man sitting in the boat looking down on sinners just throwing a life preserver. He'd been there. He knew how hard the struggle was. As Henry Nouwen called it, he was a wounded healer. This was an expression of Rich's faith. Rich had been a member here most of his life. He was confirmed in the old building at the original location, but he was at his best in his role as an usher. And we tend to think that Christians are supposed to have it all together, but in the church, We know better. The church isn't a museum for saints, but a hospital for sinners. And a Christian, as the saying goes, is only a beggar telling another beggar where to find bread. And that's what Rich did here as our head usher, making sure we could all find the same grace he had. Well, today, as we remember Rich and say goodbye, we can take comfort in knowing that of all the things Rich was to us, he was also a child of God, a lamb of God's own flock, a sheep of God's own fold, a sinner of God's own redeeming. The great shepherd gave to Rich the gift to shepherd others, and Rich used that gift very well. This is what redemption looks like. In the words of 1 Timothy, take hold of the eternal life to which you were called. Do good. Be rich in good works, generous and ready to share, so that you may take hold of the life that really is life. Rich knew what was important in his life. All of you. I think Rich knew that in giving you so much of himself, he was receiving so much more. When you give your life to others, you receive real life. Our Lord said, come to me, all you that are weary and are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you, and you will find rest for your souls. In his final days, after so much struggle, Rich longed for that rest, as we all do near the end. Rest for your soul. That's the comfort that Rich was seeking. And now, finally, he's at rest. Now that's the faith we shared with Rich. Today we gather in sadness because Rich has died, and the world is a little sadder place without him in it. But we can take comfort in knowing that Rich has received his reward. As St. Paul said, let us lay aside every weight and the sin that clings so closely, and let us run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith, who has taken his seat at the right of the throne of God. Rich took hold of the life that really is life, eternal life. That's the reward of faithfulness, of following the way of our Lord. It's the reward Christ won for us on the cross. It's the promise awaiting us all. It's our hope and our victory on this day. It's our comfort and our peace. When we lay our burdens down, there is comfort for our souls. Someday, Jesus will bring us home too, where we'll see Rich again. Until then, thank you for sharing your life with us, Rich. We'll remember you always. Rest in peace. Amen.
Shelter of the Lord, who abide in his shadow. Say to the Lord, my refuge, my rock, in whom I trust, and he will raise you up on eagle's wings.
Please stand as you're able for the prayers. Let us pray to the Lord, who is gracious and merciful and abounding in steadfast love. Eternal God, you gave Rich a new birth in baptism and entrusted him to us to know and to love. As we thank you for the life we shared, help us now to release him to your mighty keeping. Bring us all to that day when we shall stand in your presence with all your saints in light eternal. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Merciful Father, your Son wept at the death of Lazarus. Look with compassion on Rich's dearest loved ones, now experiencing sorrow and pain at his death. Give them a sure and certain hope in your loving care, that casting all their sorrow on you, they may have strength for the days ahead. Grant the tender healing of your love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Living God, source of compassion, our hearts are filled with grief at the death of Rich. Grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that where this world groans in grief and pain, your Holy Spirit may draw us near to you in faith, and to one another in love. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. God of salvation, in the stillness of our souls, we listen for your voice to know again that you are God. Quiet our restless hearts with the knowledge that you stand with us in the shadows, keeping watch over your own. Help us in the midst of things we cannot understand to believe and trust in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to life everlasting. Rekindle our faith and light the lamp of hope within our hearts. For where you lead, we can confidently go. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. O Lord, support us all the day long in this troubled life, until the shadows lengthen and the evening comes and the busy world is hushed, the fever of life is over, and our work is done. Then, in your mercy, grant us a safe lodging and a holy rest and peace at the last. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated. At this time, I'd like to ask Lorraine and the kids and their spouses to come forward. Let's gather in a semicircle here and let's one more. Rich Liljenquist, our companion in faith, we entrust you to God. Go forth from this world in the love of God who created you, in the mercy of Jesus who died for you, in the power of the Holy Spirit who receives and protects you. May you rest in peace and rise in glory, where pain and grief are banished, and life and joy are yours forever. Well done, good and faithful servant. Would you please place your hands on the casket? Let us commend Rich to the mercy of God, our Maker and Redeemer. Into your hands, O merciful Savior, we commend your servant Rich. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of the saints in light. Amen. You may return to your seats. After the recessional song, well, during the recessional song, we'll be doing a recession out to the hearse. We'll be going immediately to the graveside at Spencer Cemetery. All of you are welcome, if you wish, to join the family there, and we'll continue there. Please stand as you're able. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. And the blessing of Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be with you now and forever. Amen. Let us go forth in peace. In the name of Christ, amen. You may be seated as we listen to the recessional song, Goodbye. During that song, we'll begin the recession.
I wanted you for life, you and me in the wind. I never thought there'd come a time that our story would end. It's hard to understand, but I guess I'll have to try. It's not easy to say goodbye. All the joy we share, all that time we had to spend. Now, if I had one wish, I'd want forever back again. To look into your eyes, hold you when you cry. It's not easy to say goodbye. I remember all those great times we had. So many memories, some good, some bad. Yes, and through it all, those memories will last forever. There's peace in where you are, maybe all I need to know. And if I listen to my heart, I'll hear your laughter once more. And so I have to say, I'm just glad you came my way. It's not easy to say goodbye. I wanted you for life, you and me in the wind. I never thought there'd come a time that our story would end.